We needed consultancy from large consultancies, sometimes small as well, but especially when you get them from large consultancies. Many of the projects have lots of flexible culture, organizational culture, team culture, personal culture, and they never specify what they mean by that. Yes. So one of the tricks I sometimes provide is, when you're not completely sure that your consultants know what they are talking about, every time they use the word culture, replace that word in your head with the word magic. And then if what they said still makes sense, then most likely they don't know what they're talking about. Just a small trick. Okay. So this presentation will be fully in English, both the slides and my talk. I think you will get the slides afterwards, so some of the things will be easier to look at afterwards as well. There's not too much text on the slides, and I will try to speak relatively slow. And I have this mixed accent of Estonian and English and whatever else I pick up in airports. I will also be here for the whole day. So if you have any questions about anything I say here, then just find me during the day. And one of the positive things I think for you would be that I do understand Russian. So you can ask all the questions in Russian. I will respond in English. Because it's quite good in the point that I haven't had enough beer to be able to speak in Russian. Okay. So this is the topic store for my session today. I'm going to talk about the complexity and sense making. I will start with digital transformation, and I will then explain why these things are relevant for digital transformation. Right? In the service management world, or in the IT service management world, this is not yet very common. Yet when you go to conferences about DevOps or Azure in the world, in most of these conferences, you have one or two sessions about the Canavan framework. So I will explain what it is, and I will explain why it's useful, or why it can be useful. And then I'm going to wrap up with the continuous incremental improvement. Just a few words about myself, because some of you know me, some of you don't. So I work for a company called Language. I'm doing consultancy, mostly in Europe, but not only, around improving IT service management, project and program management in large enterprises. Before this, I was working for Axelos. So Axelos is the company who owns IT companies too. I was responsible for the product strategy and development at Axelos. So IT practitioner that was mentioned before, that was my baby. And we also released the new version of Prince 2 when I was there. So I was with Axelos. Before that, more or less 20 years in IT, IT and business management. And all those years in IT kind of have made me like a beer and wine and things like this. So there might be a correlation between working in IT and being fond of alcohol. I don't know. So this is me here competing at the beer surveyor competition a few years back in Estonia. I got a second place there. I'm not sure my problem though. So this is me. I'm going to give you one slide of digital transformation. So I'm working with, I would say, hundreds of organizations around the world, trying to figure out what it is that they mean by digital transformation, because digital transformation is a little bit like culture. It means very different things to very different people, and sometimes it means absolutely nothing. Right? On PowerPoint slides, it usually means absolutely nothing. But here's my attempt to give some indication about what it might mean based on my experience. It's not about figuring out how to leverage technology for the benefit of the organization. Right? So this is quite easy. There's a few things I believe that you should pay attention to. So again, this is based on experience. In organizations who claim that they have done digital transformation, this is what they have been doing. They have adopted a service mindset across the organization and to their customers. So they're not just providing products, but they're providing services. And there is a difference, right? Focusing on customer objectives to co-create customer value. ITIL has been talking about delivering value for many years. In the new version, ITIL 4, that will be out during next year, you will read that it's about co-creating value with the customers, right? Not delivering the value, but co-creating. Because in services, both parties need to be involved. Increasing resilience to be able to learn from experience. Very often you don't know what will work. And unless you are able to experiment and fail, it is very difficult to learn what might work, right? But that requires a change in the way your organization works. Repositioning leaders as enablers, not overgivers, right? So usual traditional management is, I'm going to tell you what to do, and I'm going to tell you how to do this. This is very, very common in many large organizations. The new way of management is, my role as a manager is not to tell you how to do things. You know best how to do things. I'm here to enable you to do your work. Right? Again, a different approach. Challenging the status quo in the organization. So moving away from things that might not make sense, as it was mentioned before, some of the things that you have right now might not make sense anymore, to have the power and to have the freedom to actually stop doing those things. And then the streamlined processes, procedures, and the use of data, stop doing things that you should not be doing. For data, you probably have lots and lots of data which can be used for machine learning to learn more about your customers, right? But when you don't know what data you have, it's very difficult to really use machine learning for anything. So this is about artificial intelligence, right? To make it work for the organization, you need data. So the question is, like, how can we achieve these things? Or how can we get closer to this situation? So first thing, or maybe the most important thing, is to apply methods and tools that are most suitable for the situation. Again, when you think about Agile, Scrum, or Kanban, or ISO, or anything like this, very often in organizations we forget to check if it actually would work for us. Right? So we get these almost religions in IT where you have to always do this for everything. You have to be agile everywhere. Every team needs to use Scrum. Everybody needs to do DevOps. Right? This does not work. Different situations require different methods. It's not that easy because the world is becoming more complex, technology is becoming more complex, and it also breaks more often because it's more complex. Right? So there are ways. Some ways how to try to figure out how to do this, right? And then there's lots of books and articles now, right? So there's lots of IT management books, process management books, business management books. But most of them have this one fundamental issue. They are confusing correlation with causation. I'm going to give an example of this mistake. So the number of people who have drowned in a pool correlates highly every year with the number of films Nicolas Cage appeared in that year. This is correlation. Causation would be to claim that because of Nicolas Cage, we have more people drowning in pools. Or we can also claim that Nicolas Cage feels the need to be in more films based on the number of people who have traveled. And so most management articles and management books confuse these things, and they claim that the number of drownings is caused by Nicolas Cage. Right? This is why it's quite difficult and dangerous to take advice from management books, unfortunately. Okay. So we get to complexity. As I mentioned before, the world is becoming more complex, and we need to somehow manage this. In a way, it means that we need to give up the illusion that we can control the world. Right? We were never, ever, ever able to control the world, but we have been running with this illusion, with this dream, for many years. Like, if we just spend a little bit more time on planning, we will be successful. Right? And we do that with every project, we do that with every initiative. If we spend just a little bit more time, or when we have failed with something, well, I wish we had more time for planning. Because if we had more time planning, it would have been successful. No. So complexity. In complexity, we talk about complex systems. Complex systems are systems where the system itself is more than just a sum of its parts. Right? So in complex systems, the agents in the system, they modify themselves and the system, and they're modified by the system. I'm going to give you two examples. One example is about complicated, and the other example is about complex. So a complicated system is something that you can take apart and put back together, and it will work, if you know what you're doing. So the example of that kind of system would be, for instance, a plane, an airplane, right? So airplane has lots of moving parts. It is possible to take airplane into small bits and then reassemble. And if you know what you're doing, the airplane will fly again. Right? And the example of a complex system is a rabbit. Bunny rabbit? Zionist? Mm-hmm. So imagine this. You take a rabbit, you make it into small pieces, and then you try to reassemble. Do you think the rabbit will stay down? Probably not. Even if you really knew the bone down, Dr. Frankenstein had his ideas about this, it didn't really work out that well. Right? So the benefit of doing this to the rabbit is you will most likely not be able to make a rabbit stew for dinner. So if you stew rabbits in my dark beer, it's amazing. Right? But it won't show rabbit. So this is the difference. The parts in rabbits, or the rabbit itself, is more than just pieces of rabbit. Right? So complex systems are like that. Most systems that include people, and that includes IT systems, because you have users and developers and so on, most systems that include people are complex systems. And in complex systems, there are certain things you can do, and certain things you can't do. Or let's say differently. You can try to do many things in complex systems, but many of them also fail. They fail by their nature. Not because you were bad, not because the system was bad, but they just do not work in complex systems. To kind of navigate the landscape of complexity, we use sense making. Right? So sense making, how can we make sense of the world so we can act in it? When we are faced with a problem, when we are dealing with a system that we need to manage, we need to do some sense making to be able to act, to be able to kind of find the best way forward. Right? So these are quotes from Dave Newman's article in 2005. There's a few things you can use sense making for, right? So avoiding conflict by knowing where you are. In many cases in organizations, when you have conflict between individuals and teams, it's because they are looking at the world through different lens. And in complex systems, it is quite likely that they are both correct at the same time, and also both incorrect at the same time, right? So how to avoid conflict by just understanding what lens are being used. Understanding the levels of uncertainty, avoiding the illusions of causality and equivalency. I mentioned causality before. In complex systems, you can't predict properly. You can have lots of guesses, but the likelihood of your guess being right is just the same as your guess being wrong. There's also a difference between predictability and dispositionality. Complex systems are dispositional. It means that complex systems have a tendency or a higher likelihood of performing in a certain way, but it's not guaranteed. Right? In ordered systems, we can kind of see them as guaranteed. Complex systems are not. I know it's a little complicated, but I will come to some of the examples as well. In IT, we very often fall in the trap of treating estimates as promises, right? So, project management, service management initiatives, is absolutely good with that. We are also, as humans, excellent at looking back at what happened and creating a storyline why this happened, right? This is one of the reasons why, if you want to catch someone lying, so when they're not telling the truth, tell them, so ask them to tell the story backwards. Not from the first moment, but back from the last moment. because constructing a false story backward is extremely difficult. Creating a lie going forward is very, very easy. We're very good at storytelling, and also in my stories. So sometimes we confuse things that we can know beforehand with making sense of what happens in the past, and then choosing the most suitable methods and tools. This brings me to Kahneman. Kahneman is the framework from a company called Cognitive Edge. It's a sense-making framework. It is not something that you implement. I want to say this immediately. This is not something to implement. You can train people in understanding this better. There are no exams. There's no certification path. You will not get the letters behind your name. It's based on natural sciences. It explains what is happening in the world. But it's not something you impose on the world, right? And the pronunciation is Canadian. It's a Welsh word. So it's a Welsh language. It means a place where you belong. In translation, more or less. The Welsh usually claim that their words don't have a direct translation to any other language. They're not like that. So this is a simplified version of Kahneman. So this is how the framework looks like. It's something that you control on an app here. Right? It's that easy. Kahneman has five domains. Right? So not five quadrants. Just again, to make sure, not five quadrants. So anything like this, it has five domains. All these complicated complex and characters. So mentioned before, the plane would sit there, the rabbit sits there. Right? And these domains are different in how we should act in them. In the middle, you have disorder. Disorder is not knowing where you are. So in many situations, we start from disorder, and then by analyzing the situation or looking at the situation, we try to figure out what to do next. Okay. So in all of the difference, or main difference between the domains is the constraints that we have. So with the obvious and fixed constraints, there is kind of only one way to go. In complicated, you have governing constraints. So there are several ways to go, but you're still quite limited in where you can go. With complex, you have enabling constraints. So you have some boundaries, some rules around what you can do, but it's mostly meant for you to help move forward and find new ways of working, not stop you from finding new ways of working. And in chaos, you have no effective constraints. But anything could happen, you can also do anything because this is a bad place to be. When you talk about practices, best practice fits in obvious, good practice fits in complicated, extensive practice is in complex. Extensive means something that has been used before, but for a different reason. An example of extensive is with dinosaurs. Dinosaurs at one point developed feathers, right? The feathers were developed, or feathers developed, because they like to stay low. And at one point, they discovered that also they can be used to fly, right? So feathers in that example are extensive. For one purpose used for another. And then in chaotic, you have normal practice. Again, two answers in the obvious domain, you know there's one answer. So this is where you can use checklists. In complicated, there are multiple answers to choose from. This is where you would use the expert knowledge. So you can work with a group of experts to find what would be the best way forward. In complex, so this is where most of the systems live. Nobody knows the answer, right? So you need to run experiments. There is no way to know the answer. So when you have tried to solve a problem for a long time and you have talked to various experts and you have failed and failed again, and then you're dealing with a complex system, which means that you need to focus on running experiments to learn more about the system rather than planning for experts, expert emergencies. And then in chaotic, the point is to act as quickly as possible. Right? So for instance, when your building is on fire, it is probably not a very good idea to start calling the members of the change advisory board to meet in 2 hours time in the building to start discussing what should be done next. Right? Because in 2 hours time, the building will not be there anymore. So you need to act fast. Some examples of how this framework can be related to IT service management. And these examples are probably more wrong than correct, but hopefully still useful. Because the point of enemies is not for categorization. When you look at the situation changes when you tweak the situation, right? So sense making is an ongoing process. You don't put the thing into one domain so that it will stay there. You need to continually assess whether it's still there or not, right? So when I give these examples, it's an indication of how you can look at things, but this is not a model or a rule to use. So for this example, is with incident management, for instance. So when you have an incident coming in the obvious domain, you will have incidents that can be solved by first level support. You will have multiple incident resolution there. Complicated will be second and third level support. Complex is brainstorming and traveling, so when nobody knows the answer, but let's try certain things. Swarming is a way of instant resolution where you have different people from different backgrounds together to try to figure out together what you might try to solve it. And then chaotic, for instance, could be major instant resolution. So you kind of enter here, right? And then based on what kind of incident it is, you find the best way how to solve that, how to address that. Another example would be request fulfillment, right? So obvious are the ones that can be solved by first level support or second service. Second one is second level support, same complicated. When you get a request that feels that it's complex, it's actually probably a change request, right? And then when it's something that feels quite chaotic, it's probably actually an incident. So you can see how this framework can also be helpful to not look at things in the wrong way. Change management, right? Different types of changes here. Again, it might start in one of these domains, but it doesn't mean that everything about that change belongs there, right? So you can start here, so there's a change request to do something, you don't exactly know how it would work. So you run a few experiments, you learn how the system works, and after that, maybe it belongs here, because now you can use external knowledge to move forward. So this is like the simplified heuristics of how to describe these domains. So here someone knows what to do and everybody agrees. Here someone can figure out what to do, not all how to agree, but you can choose an option. In complex, no one can figure out what to do, and the evidence supports different views, right? And then in chaotic, someone wants to do something now. So communication and stabilization are the most important here. I'm giving you a bonus slide as well. So if you want to look at project management also through the lens of Kaleme, this is one of the ways of looking at this. So when different types of projects might be long, where you start dealing with them, right? But as I said before, it's not categorization, so things move around. So the Kaleme framework can be used to stop trying to use the wrong methods because they don't work there, right? So the framework helps to figure out why that might be the case. And then I wanted to make one final comment about improvement. And I gave this example yesterday as well. So it's called the Hawthorne effect. The Hawthorne effect is based on a study that was done in the US, I think in the 50s, in one of the manufacturing plants, electrical plants. So the study was about productivity. The scientists studied what is the effect of lighting, so the room lighting, for one people's productivity. So the first experiment they ran was they increased lighting, so it was brighter in the room. And they measured productivity before that and after that. Right? So they found out that when you increase lighting in the room, productivity goes up. Quite expected. They then ran a second experiment. They decreased the lighting in the room and then measured productivity. What do you think would happen? Did the productivity go down or up? Up. So in both cases, less lights, more lights, productivity of people went up. So that's called the offer effect, where people react to the fact that something is being changed, not to the content of the change. Right? So when you run your improvement initiatives, this is something to keep in mind, that your progress or results might not actually be because you were extremely clever and you found this wonderful way how to work, but people just react to change itself. So a few words about improvement overall. As I said, we'll get the slides afterwards. There's a few things you can do overall, which all lead to the philosophy of IT being the innovation unit, not the cost center, right? Because in large organizations, IT tends to be the cost center. So to be successful with digital transformation, you need to understand that world is often complex, and you need to choose the right methods and techniques to manage complexity, rather than expecting to be able to plan everything, design everything, and achieve success with your next 5-year plan for digital transformation. Like you have a 5-year plan for IT implementation, 5-year plan for Azure implementation, some of you might have a 5-year plan for DevOps implementation. These things do not work because we are dealing with complex systems. So if you have felt the pain ever about these long-term plans not exactly going how you want it, then think about this, think about complexity, and look up the Canadian framework. Thank you very much. I'm on Twitter, on LinkedIn, so feel free to link with me on LinkedIn, and then I write longer articles on Medium as well, so you can read a bit about how I think there. So thank you very much.